from your sleep and dry all your tears. Today we escape. We escape. Pack and get dressed before your father hears us, before all hell breaks loose. Breathe, keep breathing. Don't lose your nerve. Breathe. Keep breathing. I can't do this alone. Sing us a song, a song to keep us warm. There's such a chill, such a chill. There's such a chill, such a chill.
Hey, thank you. Thanks, Josh. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much. That's great. So, thank you. That's really great, Josh. Thank you. So your warm heart made even the chill words at the end feel warm in one way or the other. That's really great.
Yeah, I don't know too many celebration songs, but it's the energy that I sing with it.
That's great sensitivity. I love it.
Share.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, so I almost feel like a presenter now. So we have our guest speakers today, and one of them being Zane, and one of them being Julie without an E. Normally it is like, okay, if we do an alphabetical order, then Zane would be last, but today it's going to be different. So Zane can be first. And so Zane, you attracted your own, fan club too. So there are some people here that are very much like happy with everything that you do and that you have done. And so it's really great. So special attention for that. Thank you so much, Zane, for everything that you have done and that you do. And you're so ready to do this now today. I know that for sure. Can you open your microphone? Because I actually love to talk with you a little bit. So I put myself next to you. Let me see where I am. Where am I? because then in the video that will look as if I sit next to you talking to you. So you're actually sharing about Julian from Norwich, right?
Yes, that's a piece one that I wrote.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the piece that you wrote on your website. So is that, when did Julian live? When was he present?
Yeah, she lived in the 1300s.
Mm-hmm.
So some of that I will be covering in the piece if you'd like.
Mm-hmm. Sure. This is completely free for you to do what you want. See, it is for me, and this is like the part of the Christian Mystics class that we have to relate it to yourself. It's like, okay, you can read about everyone, but why specifically? I never heard of Julian from Norwich. What is so great about it for you? So that this is I would love to hear some of that. At least, introduce her to us, please. That would be great.
Well, one of the things that's appealing to me about Julian is she brings in the beautiful feminine mothering aspect, and she was actually the first one to do that. So it's just, I don't know, it's such a sweet and gentle and loving energy about her, what she went through, the horrific experience in her visions, the absolutely cloistered life that she lived as an anchoress. So she was totally free of the outer world in that sense, and the thoughts and feelings and all of that. She was within her cell. And so she was, in that sense, she was empty of the world and full of God and full of spirit, and all this beautiful stuff came through her that she wrote down initially in the short text. And then as the years passed and she had more revelation about it, then she wrote a longer version of it. And so, it's just a legacy of love that she gave. And one of the things that she shared is she felt, I love this, she said she felt like God is like clothing, that God is our clothing and God just surrounds and enfolds us. And that's such a beautiful symbol and an image.
So Zane, do you want to share something about your website too, like the piece that you shared on the website? You want to tell us a little bit about the story of her?
Would it be okay if I just read it? Because paraphrasing it is, mm-hmm. I won't be able to really do it justice in the sense of all the things that mm-hmm. Come out about her. Mm-hmm. And the context, the background of the time she lived in, which in some ways are a bit similar to ours.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, I think it captures a lot of the elements of the mystical life and then the ultimate experience of the spiritual summit.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't know if we have enough
time. In what way is that expressed in the piece that you have on your website? In what way is that expressed, a mystical life?
Well, it's the experiences she went through and some mm-hmm. of the things I just said, because she was absolutely, I mean, when she was a cloistered nun, but then she became what is called an anchoress. Mm-hmm. So that was more of a cloistered situation. And it was like they did like a funeral rite for her in the sense when she entered that. And she took a vow that if she ever left it, that she would be excommunicated. Mm-hmm. So she lived within this space with her cat, and she could look out on this garden, and she had a small window where she could see the see and hear the church services. But she was just left to the silence in the inner world and to her longing for God. And she spoke with Jesus during this horrific time when she had these visions, when it was like she was virtually dying. Mm-hmm. And so she talked to Jesus and she talked to God, and God talked to her through sort of pictures. He gave her visions and pictures, mm-hmm. which is what she called the showings.
Yeah. Yeah. So an anchoress, what is an anchoress actually?
An anchoress is, it's a Greek word, and it means secluded or enclosed.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
So you're completely more than a nun. I mean, she was in this little space and food was brought to her, and someone came and cleaned her little area. And so she was completely for probably 20 plus years enclosed in this small area.
Wow.
Just left alone with God.
That's an extreme 40 days, right?
Yes. Very much. But she did it because she had such longing, and she wanted the full union with God, and she attained that. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the legacy that she left for all of us today.
Mm-hmm. So she wrote a couple of books, is that so? Is that our scripts?
She wrote initially what I said, she wrote them in very simple language, mm-hmm. and she was a contemporary of Chaucer. And so it's believed that she was the very first woman to ever write a book. Mm-hmm. So she did write them down initially in a very short prose about what those visions were and what nice. Came through, what God showed her. And then, like I said, over the years, as she had more inner understanding and unfoldment of them, then she wrote what was called then the longer text, what, you know, scholars and stuff call the longer text, which I think it's like three times longer than the original one she wrote down.
So, and you have recognitions with her too, except for the fact that you think it's lovely what she did. You have a recognition with her, right?
I think so, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you there recognize she was, yourself.
Living with her cat.
You love, yeah. You love to live like that.
Apparently, well, that's what she came to do, yeah. Apparently. To
but
do
that's
that.
Also what you would, what would attract you?
Well, not in this lifetime per se. I feel that has been so in the past, probably. But today,
well, this is what I mean. It's very familiar to you.
Yes,
I know for
exactly.
sure because you're
it is.
You're the one who made so many transcripts, and that was so natural.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is.
So it's coming from somewhere. So that's
absolutely.
Beautiful to see that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. And in
how
several
beautiful.
Places.
Yeah.
Like, I just have this funny sense that I ought to just be able to be fluent in French. Mm-hmm. And I'm not. And I took it in middle school and high school, but I wasn't a very good student. Mm-hmm. But I feel, and that comes from somewhere. It's like I just mm-hmm. ought to be able to speak it because I was there and in as a nun, sure, as in one of the places.
So did you have visions about that too?
Oh, no. Can I read the very last thing that she
absolutely.
Said in the
absolutely.
In the long
yeah, please.
That she ended it? It's just beautiful. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is from the final words from the last chapter of the long text. Mm-hmm. And from the time that it was revealed, I desired many times to know in what was our Lord's meaning. And 15 years after and more, it was said, "What? Do you wish to know your Lord's meaning in this thing? Know it well. Love was his meaning. Who reveals it to you? Love. What did he reveal to you? Love. Why does he reveal it to you? For love. Remain in this, and you will know more of the same, but you will never know different without end."
Wow. Awesome. Wow, that's great. That's lovely. Thank you, Saint.
That's You're welcome.
Beautiful. Wow.
Lillian de Waters was a student of Mary Baker Eddy's and a very good healer. And what I loved about her is she was much more freeform. To me, she's the forerunner of Joel, is that she really emphasized the need for all healing, all expansion of consciousness, which that's all this is, right? Is going higher into the vast forever. Is a very intimate, private, personal thing, right? That's really not bound by religion. It's bound by truth. It's bound by principle. And it's bound by receptivity. And that's the thing that I really loved about her. She wrote about 30 books of her own. She started her own publishing company. She eventually left Christian Science. And for the same reasons that I did, is she said, consciousness is ever unfolding. You know, we never stop, and we don't stop because of our religious designation, right? Christian, Jew, Muslim. We have to keep growing higher in our awareness because truth is ever unfolding. And I really appreciated that about her and found just the emphasis on integrity, and the emphasis on all healing is based in principle. So you never have, whether it's a major thing or a minor thing, you are in principle. It's like flying a plane, right? You don't want your pilot to be flying a plane on personal sense, right? He's gonna stick to the principles he's been taught. And that's what I loved about her. She was really a renegade. She was really someone that I think brought in the whole New Thought School. I think Mary Baker Eddy was very strict in her application, but that was probably also her mission. But I felt like Lillian was one of the teachers that welcomed all to just come and grow a little bit larger. So I really like her because I feel like she was always like, just lighten up and heal. You know, like lighten up, go higher. And she also said a lot of things about Albert Einstein, that at the end of the day, we are only vibration, and where you are is only in relation to where you are in vibration. And I find that very inspiring. So I don't get bogged down in personality or traumatic things, right? Is that we are always free to go higher in our consciousness. So this begins. There can be no actual process of transforming or readjusting either the personal mind or the body, for they have no real being. And the value of treatment lies in knowing this. Perfect being, perfect form, perfect experience cannot change nor alter, and nothing can reverse any one of the divine ideas present in the infinite variety and abundance now and here. We may demonstrate our joy, health, and harmony by knowing there is no concept in mind of sorrow, loss, or discord. There are no mistakes in a universe lighted by the presence of wisdom. And in reality, there is no one who could believe contrary to the truth of spirit, since man is the very presence of this truth. Man is the power of the word. Man is the proof of omnipotence, omniscience, and the omnipresence of God. This is why he can demonstrate a sufficiency in all things.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, here it is. It's on page 5. So I thought it was 19, but I don't know. So here it is. The answer is that we should take another step forward. We should let go of all anxiety or concern about the problem in the contemplation, joy, and grandeur of ourselves as truth. We should let go of all anxiety or concern about the problem in the contemplation, joy, and grandeur of ourselves as the truth, the being of changeless perfection and immovable nature, and the principle which is inevitable, certain, and fixed. And the principle is this: I am the truth. And not a student of truth. I am the truth. We may now acclaim, and as such, I am established in perfection and completedness to which nothing can be added nor be taken away. So then it's about seeing and feeling this completely. We have no desire or thought for any other form of prayer or treatment. It's like, I am the truth. I'm not a student of truth. That's more like the idea. And I love that, because this is in fact what I share a lot too. It's like talking about the Christian mystics. This is a whole initiation process. You're going to recognize yourself as truth. That is the initiation, you know, and in whatever way that can come to you, that's lovely. It doesn't matter, like whatever you can hear, apply and accept and use is then for you. That was specially for you. That was like tailor-made for you.